One of you for coming to show your love and support for Norm's family. That's much appreciated by them, I'm sure. Family would be with you this morning. Let's bow for prayer. Our Father, just pray that you would come in the power of your Holy Spirit and just be here to comfort and bless the family with the sense of your presence and the knowledge of your love this morning. Holy Spirit, we just pray that you would have your way in this service this morning, and we'll give you the praise for what you'll do in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor McKay, will you come and read the obituary, please?
I want to express my personal sympathies to the family and this unexpected time that we're having to go through. And as much as I'll be missing Norm and his face, his smile there at Omega, I know it doesn't compare to what you're going to be facing, but we pray for your comfort or to help you through this. I'll read the obituary. Norman Lee Rorta, son of John and Anna May DeWinter Rorta, was born September 22nd, 1934, in Marion County near Pella, Iowa. He grew up on a farm near Montezuma and graduated from the Montezuma High School. Norm enlisted in the United States Army on September 1st, 1954. One of the 2 years Norm served in the service, he spent 18 months overseas. He was discharged September 1st, 1956. Norm met the love of his wife, Dina Mae Johnson, 1957, and they married in April 5th, 1958, at the First Church of the Nazarene there in Oskaloosa. They soon moved to Montezuma and lived there until 1963 when they returned to Oskaloosa. Norm and his brother Virgil owned and operated Dime Delivery, a local delivery service in Oskaloosa, for several years before going to work for Bloom Builders as a semi-truck driver. He finished his working career driving a truck for the Pella Corp. He worked there for 25 years. He retired in 2020. Norm was a member of the Omega Church. Norm was a member of the Masonic Lodge, American Legion. He enjoyed playing golf with his son Randy, playing pool. He was an avid Chicago Cubs and Iowa Hawkeye fan. Norm passed away Thursday, August 13, 2020, at the age of 85 years, 10 months, and 21 days. Norm's family includes his wife, Dina of Oskaloosa, three sons, Mark and Shauna Rorta of Beacon, Michael Rorta of Fawcett, Missouri, and Brent Rorta of Oskaloosa. Seven grandchildren, Christopher and Melissa Rorta, Brandy and Jason Van Zomeren, Deanna and Andy Green, Megan and Chris Durham, Kristen Rorta and Chad Black, Zeb, Kelsey Williams, Jason and Ely Lineweber, 11 great grandchildren, Seth, Avery, Tatum, Boston, Willow, Bailey, Kale, Drake, Kiker, Wendy, and Max. I hope I said those names the way they're supposed to be said. He is also survived by four brothers, Elmer and Delaney Rorta of Oskaloosa, Lyle and Judy Rorta of Montezuma, Virgil and Rosie Rorta of Barnes City, and Bruce and Judy Rorta of Montezuma. Four sisters, Patricia Davis of Oklahoma, Linda Mason of Colorado, Marge Clayton of Grinnell, Sharon and Frank Fowler of Grinnell. In addition to his parents, Norm was preceded in death by a son, Randy, three brothers, Harlem, Lauren, and Marvin, and three sisters, Joyce Stone, Barb Foster, Marilyn Cook.
Thank you, Pastor McKee. You have become quite a large family. I understand that Norm was one of 15 children. So, what a family. Well, please enjoy another song selected by family entitled Farther Along. Why
Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it.
The scripture that I'm reading this morning is in the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back. And I will take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me."
Thank you.
Say to you, the family of Norm Rorta today, some thoughts came to my mind and I'd like to share those with you this morning. Whenever a loved one passes, we automatically think that's a bad thing, and it is, because God never intended for man to die at all. He intended for us to live forever, but then sin came into the picture because man decided to do things his way and not God's way. And so now all men sin and die. But there is good news that is related to death, and that good news is there's hope in Jesus Christ. I want you to know that this morning, hope for eternal life. So I just want to talk to you for a moment about this good news that is of eternal significance, the good news of the love of God. Can I tell you this morning that God loves you? I know that because He loves me. If He can love me, He can love you as well. I want you to know that in spite of your experience of life, what that has been, or even in this moment when the grief of death is heavy upon your hearts, God loves you. He loves you so much that He sent His only begotten Son into this world to die in your place, to take your sin upon Himself. That's the good news that brings hope for eternity, even in the certainty of death. Norm and I often had a conversation about the end of life, death. Norm would always say, well, I'm not afraid. I'm ready when my time comes. That'll be it, and I'm ready to die. He was ready to go meet Jesus, and I really believe that he was. I want to tell you, I've been a hospice chaplain for 6 or 7 years, and I've had the opportunity to talk to many people who are near death. And you know, I have yet to meet a person who did not think they were on their way to heaven. I think some people just subconsciously believe that everybody goes to heaven. Or they believe they'll never die. Or at least they don't want to think or talk about death. But I can tell you, death is a reality because the scripture says it's appointed unto man once to die, but then comes the judgment. So this raises a question. If everyone is automatically going to heaven, then why is there a judgment? The Bible talks about many things. It talks about heaven and hell. And if we believe there's a heaven, then we must also believe there is a hell and a lake of fire. If we believe that all people go to heaven, then why is there a place called the lake of fire where people will suffer eternal torment? If we believe the Bible in one point, then we have to believe it in all points. It's either true or it is not. So when it says there's a judgment day coming, there's a judgment day coming, a day when everyone who has ever lived will stand before God and give an account concerning their life on earth. At that moment, only one thing will matter, and that is, what did you do with Jesus Christ? Who was he? Is he your savior, or is he a myth? That's your decision. The Bible is the account of Jesus Christ. The Old Testament speaks of his coming as the one who will suffer and die for mankind. The New Testament tells of his being here as Emmanuel, God with us, to live and walk among us, and eventually take all of our sins upon himself and die on a cruel, rugged cross. That's amazing grace. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. History is really his story. The story of the one who took upon himself all the sin of mankind and died in our place to give us the possibility of salvation and eternal life, a home in the Father's house, as Pastor McKay read. That's the good news. The text also says he's coming again. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. That's a future event. But as certainly as Jesus has come the first time, he will be coming the second time. He will come to receive to himself those who have believed on him and received the good news of the love of God. Well, what does it mean to believe? If you believe something, then you're free to act on what you believe, right? My dad loved to go catfishing in the Nishnabotten River. And on Sunday, after the baseball game, and I could hardly wait till the baseball game was over to go fishing. And one particular Sunday afternoon, we went to a place where in order to get there to fish, you had to walk across this deep ditch on a log. My dad went first. He walked across. He weighed 235 pounds. So me, at about 100 pounds, I believed that it would hold me up. So what's the logical thing you do if you believe? You act on it. I walked across the log. It held me up. It didn't break. So if we believe Jesus Christ is the Savior of mankind, well, what does it mean to act on that belief? Well, it means to put our trust in him and live by what he said in the Word of God. So what did Jesus say? Well, Pastor read Jesus' words. You believe in God, believe also in me. Well, what do we have to believe? Well, Jesus also said that all have sinned and missed the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. So we have to believe that we are lost sinners destined for eternal death and torment in the lake of fire. Separation from God. But this is where the good news of God's love comes in, beloved. In John 3, Jesus is having this conversation with a man by the name of Nicodemus. And Nicodemus was a very, very religious man. He read the scriptures, and back then they were written on a scroll, and he could stick a pen through the scroll and tell you what letter or what word it would go through on the next roll. He knew the word of God. But he knew there was something about Jesus that he did not have. So I came to him at night to talk to him about what that something was. He wanted to know a solution. And Jesus simply said to him, Nicodemus, you must be born again. As surely as you were born physically, you must be born spiritually. Y'all know that you were born physically. You may not remember that experience, but you're here as evidence of your physical birth. And as certainly as you know of your physical birth, you need to know of your spiritual birth. You need to have an experience with Jesus. The conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus continued until Jesus finally spoke to him the words that all of us have heard at some point in our life. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's the good news of God's love. God in his love moved toward man. We didn't move toward God. God moved toward us in his only begotten Son, born of a virgin in Bethlehem, as the Messiah who suffered and bled and died for you and I. But the good news is that he has risen from the dead. And in Christ we will also be raised to life. He's coming again as the reigning king, the king of an eternal kingdom. He will come with his holy angels, and he will separate those who have believed and those who have not believed. And those who have believed will go with him into the Father's house, and those who have not believed will go into the lake of fire and eternal torment. A question I've always asked my hospice patients is, are you ready to meet Jesus? But somebody said to me recently, that's not the question you should ask. The question you should ask is, are you ready to stand before God on the judgment day? That's a good question. I'm going to ask that. As I said earlier, everyone believes they are going to go to heaven. But the truth is, there's a day of judgment coming when God will decide who is going to be in his heaven. And it will be those who have believed in Jesus Christ. Are you prepared for the judgment day? If not, then you need to get prepared. So how do we get prepared for the judgment day? Well, whenever you're getting ready for some event, there's things that you have to do, right? But one of the first things you think about is, well, when is this event going to take place? And the problem is, we don't know when Jesus is coming back again. Jesus said in Matthew 24:44, therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. I didn't get up this morning expecting Jesus to come, did you? Probably not. So this could be the day, this could be the hour, and Jesus comes. So what do we do about that? Well, we get prepared right now, right now, so that we will be prepared when the Son of Man comes. So how do we prepare? Well, most people believe if you're good enough, you're going to be okay. Or if you're conservative, fiscally, politically, morally, if you're just as good as the neighbor, maybe a little better. But Jesus said, it is by grace that you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So how do we experience this grace that we just heard Elvis singing about? It's only by giving up trying to make it on our own and accept Jesus' offer of salvation by his blood. That is by agreeing with Jesus that we are lost and undone, and then doing what Jesus said in his word in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We have to accept the fact that we are lost, that we're dead in trespasses and sins. But we can be made alive in Jesus Christ, beloved. Then we stay prepared by doing what Jesus said in Mark 8:34-37. If any of you would be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. Is anything worth more than your soul? So let me ask you, is there anything in your life that you are hanging on to that's more important to you than Jesus Christ? Whatever it is, that's what you must confess to Jesus Christ, to the Father, and ask to be forgiven of and cleansed from, that you might have everlasting life. God's not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. He's a God of love. He didn't come to condemn the world, but to save the world. So in closing, I'm going to ask you that question that Jesus asked his disciples long ago and still asks them today. Is anything worth more than your soul? I know that you are grieving over the loss of your loved one. Your grief is very real. And my heart is out to you. Although not on the level you're feeling the loss, I'm feeling the loss of Norm too. Norm was more than just one of my parishioners. Norm was a friend. We did things together, and I was amazed at the wisdom that Norm had. I remember one day we went to the Farmers Home Administration office, and they had a copier, and it was a big thing that they wanted to give to the school. And they asked if I could come and get it and take it there. Well, I was talking to Norm, and I said, Norm, will you go with me to get that thing? And he said, sure. So we went in my pickup, and he said, I'll bring a rope. I said, what are you going to do with a rope? He said, oh, you'll see. When we got there, he put that rope underneath the copier. He says, I'll get up in the pickup, and I'll lift on the rope, and you lift on the copier. You know, that thing just flipped right up in the truck. This guy really knows how to do stuff. So I'm going to miss Norm. I'm going to miss conversations with him. But I have peace that Norm is with Jesus. Not because he was a good man, even though he was a good man. Not because he went to church regularly. He went to church regularly. Or that he was conservative, and he was very conservative. Some might say he was kind of a tightwad. Not to offend any Dutchman, but you're a Dutchman. That Norm is in heaven because he believed on Jesus Christ. Can I tell you that someday you'll be where Norm is? You'll be lying in a casket, maybe right here at the Langkamp Funeral Home. Will you want people to feel at peace that you are in heaven with the Lord? Then get prepared today. God loves you and wants you to be with him in his house for eternity. All he asks is that we agree with him that we have sinned and we don't deserve to go to heaven or have eternal life. But in his love, he offers us eternal life if we will acknowledge and confess our sins and ask him to forgive us. I don't know where you are with the Lord Jesus this morning, but I can assure you that doesn't matter. He's willing to forgive you no matter what has been a part of your life or what's going on in your life right now. I know that he will forgive you because he forgave me. I've not always been a preacher wearing this tie and this white shirt. You see, I'm an aging hippie. I lived through the days of drugs and sex and rock and roll and down with the establishment. Don't trust anyone over 30. Tune in, turn on, and drop out. That's my generation. I lived all of it. But God saved me and changed my life. And he can do the same thing for you. That's my prayer for you this morning. He wants to forgive you. In a moment, we're going to listen to a song entitled, Take My Hand, Precious Lord. While you listen to that song, will you just ask the Lord to forgive you and take your hand and lead you on through your life and into eternal life with him? Thank you for listening.
Precious Lord,
In prayer. Heavenly Father, we've come to the end of this service. We know that we have not come to the end of our time of grieving. And so we're calling upon your name. That you continue to be with the family the days ahead. Lord, you know the secrets of our hearts. We pray that you would not shut your ears of mercies to our prayer, but you would spare us. Jesus, that you would save us. Lord, we pray that as not only we've been celebrating Norm's life, remembering his life, Lord, we pray also in this time there'd be a celebration of one who's calling upon the name of Jesus and saying, Jesus, save me, be merciful to me. We know that you are going to be our eternal judge. We pray that you would help us find the pathway of life that you've opened up for us. And in the midst of life, we experience death. But we thank you for your words of truth that's been given, for your promises that have been given. Most important right now, I'm thanking you, Jesus, for your mercy as we just humble ourselves before you. We think of what John said in Revelation. I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, write from henceforth, blessed are the dead that die in the Lord. Even so says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works may follow them. We plead, Jesus, for your mercy, as we humble ourselves before you today. Again, we ask your comfort for the family as we go through this day, through the weeks, the months to come. We ask for your comfort in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.